In the story of the airships, the Roaring Twenties was to be a decade of glamour and conquest. The Graf Zeppelin would rewrite the record books with the first passenger flight around the world. And Italian airships would venture into uncharted corners of the globe. But the race to dominate the skyways would result in some of the most spectacular and controversial calamities of the era. During the Great War, German Zeppelins made scores of attacks on London and across Europe. After the war, Britain fought to have them banished from the skies, not merely to settle the score, but to protect her own commercial interest in the gigantic technology. But in the early 1920s, the Zeppelin Company was allowed to build one final airship for the American Navy as war reparations. The world's largest flying machine, the Los Angeles, was flown across the North Atlantic to America, where her creator, Hugo Eckener, was given a hero's welcome. With the Zeppelin all but confined to history, Eckener was offered a dramatic solution to save his company from ruin. The giant rubber and tire manufacturer Goodyear had invited Eckener to form a joint venture to build Zeppelins in the United States.
Goodyear had been in the aeronautical supply business. They had built balloons, they had built blimps for the United States Navy and the U.S. Army. And Goodyear was a leader at the time in aeronautical engineering and the development of such things as impermeable fabrics.
Vice President P.W. Litchfield was convinced that with Zeppelin's brilliant technology, Goodyear could take the lead in not only military, but passenger airships.
Paul Weeks Litchfield was absolutely convinced, as were a lot of people, that the future of long-distance intercontinental flight lay with the rigid airship and not with the airplane.
For Eckener, it was one of the most difficult commercial decisions of his life.
Eckener was not entirely thrilled about this in the beginning, and some of his directors even less so. But it began to seem like a pretty logical thing.
The result was the formation in 1923 of the Goodyear Zeppelin Corporation. For a one-third stake, Zeppelin handed over its design secrets, along with chief engineer Dr. Karl Arnstein and 12 other German experts who built wartime Zeppelins. On paper, the new alliance of American capital and German know-how was a world beater. All that was needed was a Navy construction contract to kickstart the enterprise. But the American government's confidence in the airship was soon to be seriously dented. Throughout 1925, the Navy's two new airborne flagships, Shenandoah and Los Angeles, were clocking up more flying time as public relations billboards than in fleet operations. It was a propaganda strategy that was about to backfire tragically.
On September 2, 1925, the USS Shenandoah took off from Lakehurst for a trip along the American Midwest to Minneapolis for a county fair. On the morning of September 3rd, it encountered horrible storms over southeastern Ohio. It hit a terrible squall for which a ship of its type had never been designed. And broke into three pieces.
The wreckage was strewn across three crash sites in southern Ohio. The bow and tail landed 12 miles apart. Of the 43-man crew, 14 died, including the captain. Over the coming days, souvenir hunters descended on the crash sites and stripped the wreckage bare, leaving little for a board of inquiry investigation into the reason for the crash.
And it was a very traumatic experience. But it was always blamed on the weather. The process of following an airshore circuit instead of flying with the fleet sort of escaped attention.
It was not the publicity the Navy had sought. And the loss of the first American-built rigid airship darkened optimism in America for lighter-than-air machines. In 1926, the world's interest in airships shifted to Italy. Under dictator Benito Mussolini, Italy was expanding her influence both in Europe and on the world stage. Her shipbuilders were creating state-of-the-art ocean liners and warships. And the military boasted one of the world's leading airship designers, General Umberto Nobile. Nobile's expertise lay in building small, versatile airships called semi-rigids. Unlike Zeppelins, which had a full metal frame, semi-rigids had only a part frame at the bottom of the envelope.
Airship people have never been very enthusiastic about semi-rigid airships. It's a hybrid, essentially, between a blimp and a large airship. And as someone once commented to me, it involves the worst features of both.
In 1926, the Aero Club of Norway purchased a Nobile-built airship for famed Norwegian explorer Roald Amundsen, the first man to reach the South Pole. His ambition was to become the first man to conquer the North Pole by air. Nobile was contracted to pilot the ship, which had been renamed Norge. On April 10, 1926, Nobile set off for the Arctic island of Spitsbergen, 600 miles from the pole. It was the beginning of one of the greatest, yet controversial, aerial sagas of the 20th century. Amundsen and his financier, American millionaire adventurer Lincoln Ellsworth, sailed to Spitsbergen, where an advanced crew had assembled an ingenious hangar for the airship. In early May, the airship arrived at the base camp after an epic flight from Rome via England and Russia. But Nobile found Amundsen distracted. A few days earlier, a ship had sailed into King's Bay with a group of unexpected visitors. Amundsen greeted the party, led by Lieutenant Richard E. Byrd of the U.S. Navy. When the American began assembling a Fokker ski plane, Amundsen realized he was about to be upstaged by Byrd.
And at first he wouldn't tell anybody what he was doing there. wasn't until he'd been there for very few days that he revealed that his purpose was to be the first to fly to the North Pole. He didn't put it in these words, but I'm going to beat you fellas to the punch, is what, essentially what he was saying, and a lot of people didn't like that.
With the airship still undergoing final preparations, Bird took off. After only 15 and a half hours in the air, he returned with the news that he'd succeeded in flying over the North Pole. It was too good to be true.
From virtually from the very moment that it returned, controversy developed. The Fokker trimotor plane had a maximum cruising speed of about 70 miles an hour. That particular plane was carrying skis, and that reduced airspeed by 2, perhaps 4 miles per hour. The plane could not, within 15 and a half hours, could not have gone to the North Pole and come back within the time that Bird said that it had taken them.
Amundsen put the Bird controversy behind him. His mission, he now claimed, was far more daring. To fly over the pole, yes, but to continue on and be the first humans ever to see what lay beyond. On the morning of May 11, 1926, they set off on their journey of discovery. It was to be the most hazardous journey ever attempted in an airship. With 16 men on board, there would be no turning back. The following morning, at 1:30, they reached the pole. In the eerie Arctic light, Amundsen and Ellsworth dropped their national flags. But Nobile upstaged them, dropping an even larger Italian flag given to him by Mussolini. Amundsen was furious. He considered Nobile little more than hired help. Beyond the pole, the real journey began. Ahead of them, 1,000 miles of unexplored land.
They didn't have an easy time of it. Ice formed on the propellers, and the rotation of the propellers threw the ice off into the bag. Fortunately, it didn't puncture any gas cells, but it sure tore a lot of holes in the along the keel area.
After days battling headwinds, snow, and fog, the airship made a heavy force landing near the isolated Alaskan village of Teller. No one was injured, but their valiant airship was beyond repair. Amundsen was hailed around the world for making the first aerial crossing of the Arctic. But he was far from generous in sharing the credit with Nobile and his airship. To Amundsen's displeasure, the flamboyant Italian airship commander was invited to meet the United States president on the way home. And on arrival in Italy, Nobile was decorated by Benito Mussolini. Nobile soon announced he was preparing another mission to the Arctic. A mission that would thrust Italy to the forefront of polar research. But the grand project would create a political storm that would ultimately see him branded as a traitor and cost the life of his greatest detractor, Amundsen. In late May 1928, after a number of successful trial flights, Nobile took off from Spitsbergen in his new airship, Italia. 20 hours later, he looked down on the North Pole. But deteriorating weather soon forced the Italia to turn back for base camp. She never arrived. A call went out from Spitsbergen for assistance. Mussolini refused to help, but six nations sent rescue parties. Even Raoul Amundsen put aside his strong anti-Nobile feelings, and in a chartered French seaplane, he went in search of his old adversary. Finally, after weeks of searching, rescuers spotted wreckage and survivors. A Swedish ski plane rescued Nobile, but had no room for his eight crewmen. They were later rescued by a Russian icebreaker. The airshipmen had survived a month on the ice, but six other men who were in the hull had been blown away on the wind and were never found. For Nobile, the drama was far from over. He was accused of not only incompetence, but cowardice for allowing himself to be the first rescued. The fascist press called for him to be court-martialed and shot. While Mussolini honored the victims' families and survivors, Nobile was later stripped of all his military honors. Italy's most famous aviator was finally hounded out of his country and forced to seek sanctuary in Russia, where his genius was employed building airships for the military. In one of the tragic ironies of the story, Raoul Amundsen never returned from the search. He had perished in the environment he knew better than anyone, looking for a man he had vilified and believed incapable of survival. Germany in the mid-1920s was still in crisis. The Weimar government was unable to pay its war reparations, and both the far left and right of politics were stirring discontent in the streets. At Friedrichshafen, the German home of the Zeppelin Company, unemployment was rife. It had been 2 years since the company had joined forces with Goodyear, and the promise of building airships for the American military had not been fulfilled. But Zeppelin chief Hugo Eckener continued to dream of German-built airships. Over the next few years, he would create one of the most lauded and record-breaking aircraft in the history of flight, the Graf Zeppelin. In late 1926, Germany's former enemies finally lifted their restrictions on airship construction. To drum up funds, Eckener and former Navy airshipmen traveled throughout Germany and neighboring countries, lecturing about their airship of the future. Within 6 months, the world's biggest airship was under construction at Friedrichshafen. Some of the funds had come from public donations. And under pressure from the persuasive Eckener, the cash-strapped government somehow found more than a million marks to help put the pride of Germany back in the air.
In addition to being possibly one of the most gifted natural pilots, Hugo Eckner was also a very, very shrewd businessman and a consummate politician. He had no problem speaking directly and frankly when it came to asking for what he perceived to be the specific needs for himself, his corporation, and the future of the Zeppelin airship.
On the 8th of July 1928, Count Zeppelin's daughter christened the new airship Graf Zeppelin in honor of her father. For Eckener, more was riding on this creation than any previous Zeppelin. Her destiny, he said, is to prove once and for all that airships are either the way to the future of air travel or the final downfall of a defective concept. People travelled to Friedrichshafen from all over Germany to see Zeppelin's biggest and best airship yet take to the skies for its trials.
To see one of these take off, float up and then start its engines full ahead, and then swim, I mean, as Eckner himself put it, swim like a fish. It didn't fly, it didn't thunder like an aeroplane. It voyaged. It's just magic.
Wherever Eckner's wonder machine went, it was greeted with wild jubilation.
He knew psychology backwards and forwards. He used to remark to a friend of mine, quote, "I am not unaware of the psychological impact of flying something three city blocks long, 500 feet over the head of people in the street."
But Eckener's ambitions for the Graf Zeppelin were far greater than the pursuit of accolades. He was going to prove to the world that airships were the future of air travel. In 1927, Charles Lindbergh flew the first non-stop crossing from America to Paris by aeroplane. Zeppelin and British-built airships had already conquered the North Atlantic years earlier. In October 1928, Hugo Eckener decided to increase the stakes by attempting the first non-stop intercontinental passenger flight from Europe to America.
Also the most luxurious flying machine ever. It was like flying in a comfortable first-class Bavarian hotel. The rooms were not big, but they were very luxuriously appointed. You had a lovely dining room and sitting room with first-class starched white tablecloths and silver cutlery and beautiful Zeppelin crockery and so on.
Her 20 passengers included 5 German government officials and 6 media representatives. The only woman aboard, British-born Lady Grace Drummond Hay, was a star reporter for the Hearst Press. Her column, Radio Daily to New York, captured both the pleasures and privations of the world's first passenger flight, between the old and the new worlds.
It is a huge experiment. The tiny kitchen is only a few feet square and inadequate to supply luxuries for passengers, as well as cook for 14 members of the crew. But the passengers are all happy and pleased with the voyage. The Zeppelin swings in space like a cradle, swaying gently to the lullaby of the winds on the silver canvas. Lady Grace Drummond Hay.
But on the evening of the second night, Echener's dream turned into a nightmare and thrust the Graf Zeppelin onto the front pages of newspapers around the globe. Nearing the mid-Atlantic, the ship received a weather report warning that a storm front was approaching from the northwest. Towards midnight, the entire northern sky was aflame with almost incessant lightning. Hugo Echener was worried what the next few hours might bring. The Graf Zeppelin was an unproven craft in bad weather. The next morning, the ship ran straight into the great storm at full speed. The combined impact was 150 miles per hour and sent shockwaves through the ship. Graf Zeppelin stood up to the turbulence, unlike America's Shenandoah, but she had not emerged unscathed. The storm had damaged a tail fin. Volunteers, including Echener's son, went aloft in 50-knot winds and pelting rain to make urgent repairs. If they failed, the ship would be uncontrollable. With the Graf losing altitude, Echener ordered an urgent message to be radioed to the U.S. Navy for assistance. Across America, the press became intoxicated with the drama unfolding in the North Atlantic. With 21 warships standing by, radio contact was lost with the Graf. But Echener finally got a second message through to say that all was well and they no longer needed help. After 3 days and yet another encounter with a violent storm, the American coastline came into view. Instead of heading directly for Lakehurst, Echener decided to capitalize on press and public interest by flying over Washington and New York. A din of horns, sirens, whistles and cheers coming from below drowned out the noise of the airship's engines.
On our arrival in New York, Echener was terribly emotional and so was everyone. Lady Grace Drummond Hay.
She was wildly overdue, exhausted of food and water, and bearing a gaping hole in her fin. But she was triumphant. At dusk, after an epic flight of 5,000 miles, the world's first intercontinental passenger airship landed safely at Lakehurst. An estimated 30,000 people were there to greet her. Some had been there for 60 hours. Lady Drummond Hay The first woman to travel the North Atlantic by air, was painted as the heroine of the drama and became the coast-to-coast darling of the hour. Echener was the conquering hero. He dined with President Coolidge and, together with his crew and passengers, paraded up Broadway in a snowstorm of ticker tape. With Zeppelin fever gripping America, Echener hoped to entice financiers and corporations into funding a fleet of transatlantic passenger airships. This was 1928, and airships faced stiff competition from ever faster and more opulent ocean liners. Earlier that year, Germany's Bremen and Europa both smashed the North Atlantic record. The passage of 4.5 days was roughly the same time taken by the Graf Zeppelin, but offered far greater comfort, safety, and profits. But Echener was an optimist and a showman. On his return flight over the North Atlantic, he wiped more than a day off the fastest passage by liner. Records, however, were not enough to win backing for his fleet of airships. He then turned his attention to the grandest and most audacious of publicity ventures, a fleet that would leave ocean liners and every other aircraft in its wake.
He thought that one of the best things he could do to convince people of the value of airships and the reliability of his airship, the Graf Zeppelin, was to fly it around the world.
The flight of the Graf Zeppelin around the world, which we are about to start, will be the fulfillment of our hopes regarding the airship.
The round-the-world voyage was partly funded by American newspaper magnate William Randolph Hearst. His only condition, the flight would officially start and end at Lakehurst, New Jersey. On August 15, 1929, the Graf set off with a crew of 41 and 20 passengers from 10 countries. Australian aviation pioneer and Arctic explorer Sir Hubert Wilkins joined the flight to assess the airship's potential for polar exploration. Lady Drummond Hay, by now a Zeppelin fanatic, was also aboard. She wanted to become the first woman to circumnavigate the world by air.
Ours is a little republic of democracy, where professors, king's physicians, millionaires, officers and crew live and fraternize in the most amiable harmony. Lady Grace Drummond Hay.
For most of human history, the only way of circumnavigating the world was by sea. Ferdinand Magellan's epic 16th century sea voyage had taken more than 3 years. More recently, in 1924, two United States Army biplanes hopped around the world in 6 months. After an effortless first leg across the North Atlantic, Echener was confident the Graf Zeppelin was on the way to writing its own place in history and would prove the airship's potential for a worldwide passenger service. After a stopover at Friedrichshafen in southern Germany, the Graf flew over Berlin to a rapturous welcome. Very few Germans in the street would ever set foot on an airship. But the Graf Zeppelin carried with her the common man's dream of restoring international respect for the nation. The second leg, across Russia, was to be a journey into the unknown, No airship had ever ventured into northern Asiatic skies. There was no sign of apprehension on board, but a voyage around the world was extremely risky. Ekener knew that such a daring flight with a contingent of wealthy and influential passengers could easily backfire.
It had enormous dangers. The route he chose was probably the most dangerous. It involved flying the length of Siberia.
If we didn't know it was impossible, we might almost think the Zeppelin had flown to the moon or Mars. This view is positively unearthly. Sir Hubert Wilkins.
And once you were into Siberian land space, you had no backup systems anywhere at all. If you came down in that total bubbling wilderness of swamps, you probably could survive the crash, but you wouldn't be able to survive getting out from there. They were flying over land that had never been seen from the air before, over isolated villages who took one sight of this huge flying object coming over. They would run in circles. They would run into bushes to hide. They would kneel in a crowd outside their church praying, because this was, as it were, I think in their minds, a machine of the devil.
After days of flying over the Siberian wastelands, the Graf Zeppelin approached the daunting Stanovoy Mountains.
And their way was barred by unmapped mountains over 6,000 feet high, with no known way through. And Ekener himself describes what it was like flying. You flew as if you were driving a car, left here, and then you take this one up here. And you had jagged peaks, 200 feet one side of you, 200 feet the other side of you, the ground 200 feet below you. Millions of cubic feet of explosive hydrogen gas keeping you up. He managed to get just over the pass, over the mountains, and then suddenly the whole ballgame changed. Boing! Suddenly the vast expanse of the Pacific. Blue, sunny, flat, still, nice. And they all cheered, everyone cheered.
They had travelled 7,000 miles from Berlin, the longest non-stop flight yet made. A journey taking a month by ship or 2 weeks by train had taken the airship less than 4 days. The world was now a much smaller place.
And of course they went on to Japan and to this monumental welcome.
For the residents of Tokyo, the Zeppelin was a machine of wonder and magic. The local press would print more column inches about the visit than any other event in Japanese history. If Japan's age-old isolation had come to an end, here was the proof. Ahead was another test for the Graf Zeppelin, the first attempt ever to fly the Pacific Ocean non-stop. Ekener had barely got up to cruising speed before he went in chase of a typhoon that only the day before had passed over Tokyo. By tugging on its rim, like hanging onto a tiger's tail, he would greatly enhance the ship's speed. Below, seven steamers of the American line were strung across the Pacific. They would provide weather reports on the way.
We owe it to science, humanity, and international friendship to forward this noble aerial enterprise. We now offer fervent prayers that the ship will navigate the Virgin Pacific in safety to the other shore. Lady Grace Drummond Hale.
Less than 3 days after departing Tokyo, the Graf Zeppelin flew triumphantly over San Francisco. NBC organized what was at the time the most ambitious live outside broadcast in history, reaching listeners all over America and across the world.
Just gradually approaching the heart of the city of San Francisco. It's very, very low now. Right over the heart of the city.
Early the following morning, the Graf Zeppelin, escorted by 50 naval planes, came in to land at Los Angeles. Hearst reporter Carl Van Wiegand called it a milestone.
The Pacific has been conquered. There will be no other first flight over that great ocean. This will go down as the greatest of all air adventures up to the present time. It will stir the imagination and inspire coming generations.
For Hugo Ekener, the final leg across the American continent was of the most concern. There was the unpredictable weather over the deserts of Arizona and Texas, and the potential of thunderstorm fronts from the northeast. To make matters worse, the airship was carrying a minimum of fuel and running seriously low on gas and ballast, the basic ingredients of buoyancy and altitude.
It actually was more serious for Ekener, the airship commander, than Siberia. But all went well. They came in over Chicago, which was absolutely jammed solid to see this phenomenon go overhead. Even the hospitals, the sort of dead and dying, as it were, all managed to clamber up onto the flat roof to see it go over.
After a rapturous welcome in Chicago, Ekener headed straight for New York to fly over the Statue of Liberty and officially end the voyage. In only 21 days, the Graf Zeppelin's passengers had circumnavigated the globe in absolute comfort and safety. And the official flying time of 12 days and 11 minutes was a major milestone in aviation history.
It was the most significant aviation event of that era. In political terms, Dr. Ekener had done more for German image abroad with this one flight than the Weimar government had done in the previous decade.
Dr. Ekener, it gives me a great deal of satisfaction to personally congratulate you upon so noteworthy
an Newly elected President Herbert Hoover proclaimed Ekener another Magellan, another Columbus.
I do congratulate you indeed.
I know that I am the luckiest girl in the world to have enjoyed the privilege of being the first woman to fly round the earth.
Lady Drummond Hay was by now the most famous female journalist of her time. She used her popularity to promote the airship as a safe means of passenger transport.
People ask asked me if I was afraid at all during the flight. How could I be? I have such confidence in our silver airship and in Dr. Eckner.
Eckener proclaimed that the epic flight of the Graf Zeppelin had ushered in an era of totally reliable intercontinental air travel. But if Britain had its way, Hugo Eckener would not have the skies to himself for long. Five years earlier, in 1924, the British Empire exhibition opened at Wembley. It had come as a distraction from the bad news of political unrest in Europe and strikes and high unemployment at home. During the exhibition, Prime Minister Ramsay MacDonald, leader of the first Labour government in British history, announced a grand plan to span the vast distances of the Empire with airships.
Not just any airships, but one it was decided would be state-of-the-art airship, bigger, better, more powerful than anything yet seen in Germany.
At the Royal Airship Works in Cardington, government engineers began construction of the world's largest flying machine, the R101. Her original design included accommodation for up to 100 passengers and 16 tons of cargo. And her 5 million cubic feet gas capacity would be a third more than the Graf Zeppelin. 16 individual gas cells would provide the lift. Their fabrication created hundreds of specialist jobs. Each cell had an outside layer made from linen. An inner layer was fashioned from cattle intestines. Goldbeater's skin, as it was called, had been used for centuries by artisans in the production of gold leaf. But its exceptional gas-type properties had been fundamental to the production of all airships.
It took 50 to 70,000 skins to line each cell. So in an airship, you were talking over 1 million membranes. Obviously, this was very expensive. The cells attracted rats and mice, and in any case, they'd dry out and leak in just the space of a couple of years.
At Howden, 100 miles to the north, the private firm Vickers was constructing a second airship, the R100. She was to be identical in size, but built on a budget of a mere third of her government-made sister ship, and would lack the R101's innovations in design and passenger comfort.
That difference accounts for a great deal, because the private one became known as the private airship, the other one became known as the socialist airship.
Vickers, of course, had to build it to a price, not a restraint suffered by the so-called government ship. And so, right from the outset, there was perceived to be competition between the two.
Despite her simple design, the privately built airship was a wonderful success and would soon fly across the North Atlantic without incident. The R101, however, was a disaster in the making. On her first test flights, she was found to be seriously overweight and underpowered. With the Minister for Air, Lord Thompson, eager to show her off with a flight to India, the R101 was sent back into the hangar to be lengthened and fitted with extra gas bags. When the Graf Zeppelin visited Cardington, Hugo Eckener inspected the modifications. He was dismayed at her continued handling problems.
Eckener said that ship should not fly. in its present shape. It just was an unstable, uncontrollable vehicle. But nobody was about to make any changes.
The question is, why would the government, and the Air Minister, Lord Thompson in particular, make the decision to fly to India with the R101 before she'd been sufficiently proven? First, there was clearly the pressure born of competition. The R100, the private ship, the Vickers ship, had already flown to and back from Canada. So there's professional competition, professional pride. They've done it, therefore we must. And then there was Lord Thompson himself. A somewhat overbearing figure, a man who made up his mind and knew his mind. He had been born in India. He had a dream to return to India one day as being a vice consul. What better way to arrive than in an airship, visiting the old empire with this new and highly technical instrument?
But there were also political reasons for the flight. With Indian nationalists calling for an end to British rule, the massive R101 would impress upon the people of India Britain's superior power. Whatever his motives, Thompson made the fateful decision to set off for India in October 1930 in an airship that was far from airworthy. But 8 hours later, the dream of an Empire airship scheme was in tatters. In stormy weather, the R101 was destroyed when it crashed into a field near the French town of Beauvais. Forty-eight men were killed, including Lord Thompson. Only six crewmen survived the inferno. At Cardington, not far from the hangars that housed their airship, the victims were buried in a combined grave. It had been Britain's worst aviation disaster, and brought to an end the government's rocky romance with the world's largest flying machine. It also marked the death knell of the Imperial airship program. The following year, the R100 was unceremoniously steamrolled and sold as scrap metal for a few hundred pounds. With Britain out of the race, German and American-made Zeppelins would dominate the skies of the 1930s. It was to be the era of the mammoth airship, with Hugo Eckener its master. But Eckener's dream machine would be pressed into service by an ambitious regime unparalleled in Germany's history. And fall from grace in one of the most spectacular and controversial catastrophes in the history of flight.